Will be a test at the end.
End of what?
End of what?
Oh, you'll know it.
Oh, so that's gonna be like the science wonder talk.
You'll know. The Lord will ask you the questions. Get that!
He probably forgot to tell us that.
It was just a class. It was just a class. All right. Casey, we rushed madly ahead to verse 12. And I feel that we need to again press in on verse 12, because 12, 13, and 14 are so unique to time, and I have not really been able to speak at verse 14 about it yet, because the Lord hasn't released me. So I've been able to talk all around it, but I really haven't been able to say it. So I want to look just a little closer at verse 12. Says in this first John chapter 1, verse 12, but as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on him. Alright. We stated that the word him here cannot be defined by our preconceived ideas. The word him must be defined by the context of the scriptures that we have studied up to this point. So you cannot, this is not a to as many as received and put a blank there, you know, and say, okay, him, to as many as received, blank, it's a him. And you cannot fill in that blank with anything of your own understanding. I mean, you can, but I mean, the goal would be to receive what God is trying to communicate. What God is trying to communicate to you through these passages. To not receive that is to, what is the point? You know what I mean? I mean, if he writes us a letter and says, I'll meet you in Georgia, and you say, well, I like California better, you go to California, what is the point? You know? The goal is to, you know, as many as receive him, not to write a blank, fill it in with our understanding. The goal would be either to stay with what has been the context up to this point without any other information, or to just simply say to the Holy Spirit, you know, I don't know, I don't have a clue really who this him is, and I need you to be my teacher. Guide me into all truth. To make known the Lord. That would be preferable then to as many as received him, and we describe him as, received him as Savior, that a whole flurry of information comes into your computer, your mind. If you call that him the Redeemer, or if you call that one the Lord, or the Creator of you, or whatever. We discussed this last class. So the one that is the him here must be explained to us by, once again, the Holy Spirit and the context of the scriptures. We'll make more of a delineation between the Word of God between the Word and the scriptures. But scriptures are valuable to us. The scriptures are valuable to us because the scriptures can lead us to the Word. The scriptures, if stayed within the context of what's been said, can keep us safe. We say, well, we're not in any danger if we call this him the Redeemer, and we go off believing that this is all nothing but a big explanation of salvation. Okay. You know, I mean, this may sound weird, but I don't want to do it. You know what the word sin means in the Greek? It means to miss the mark. And you know, the mark of God may be to understand, you know, here's the thing that hits a bullseye, is that him that is here may be the logos, the word, the logos, the total form concept of God, but we miss it to come over here and have the Redeemer. We don't realize that, you know, well, at least I didn't go out and do something bad. But sin is missing the mark. And God is the one who sets the standards. God is the one who sets our standards. God, when we bowed our knee to the Lord Jesus Christ, we called him Lord. We said, and we didn't just say, now I will understand you. He said, Jesus said, he said it to them and he said it to you and me. Wait for the Holy Spirit to come and explain. He'll guide you into all truth. That's what he said. He said that. He didn't say, oh, you're going to be able to speak in tongues and have lots of fun. He kept the Holy Spirit in the context of so that we wouldn't miss the mark. And to trust the Holy Spirit, but you know, we can say, I trust the Holy Spirit in some sort of passive way, no, in a very active, relational way. How do I mean that, relational way? I mean, my relationship with the Holy Spirit is defined by Jesus' words, or what we call the Scriptures. And that is, he won't speak of himself. He will guide you. He will teach you. He will show you things to come. All these things are, you know what I mean? I mean, that's okay. That is my relationship with the Holy Spirit. Thank God. I believe that. My faith comes into agreement. I come into agreement with Jesus. I now don't miss the mark in relationship to the person of the Holy Spirit and my relationship with him. So now I have an active faith that embraces the Holy Spirit as my in a daily, in a moment-by-moment walk, that I cannot know. I cannot open this book and see light. You know, I can't open this book and see reality, God's reality, apart from the Holy Spirit. I would be very presumptuous to think that I could. You know, I've often said, you know, my stepfather, before I was able to lead him to the Lord, I remember one time I came in after I got saved and I was all hyped up and everything, and I started witnessing to him and says, yeah, I know all about that Jesus stuff. You know, I mean, I know all about, he died for my sins and he rose from the dead. He started spouting back to me what I call the gospel. And I went, I remember walking off, of course I didn't know much, but I remember going, how does he know all of this? I thought, you know, but he's not saved. And he says, no, I don't. Well, anybody can know facts. But to know the truth takes the Holy Spirit. So to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, that I may know it. That's only a that. That's only with the purpose of knowing the Lord, knowing all truth. Even that must submit itself to the Scriptures and to the guidelines or the outline or the reality as described by the Scriptures itself. The Holy Spirit is my teacher, and he is my guide, and he will. And I trust that. And I depend on that. I mean, I don't just kind of, once again, passively trust. I depend on that. Regular. Daily. And if it's not there, I don't, you know, in fact, I go so far, I don't go, oh my God, I failed. I'm sorry, how can I fail to lay hold of something I can't apart from the Holy Spirit? You might even be afraid to do this. I'd say, Holy Spirit, it's your job. You can't bring me into all truth. Jesus said that. That's the words of Jesus. And I'm looking to you, and if you're not going to do it, I used to say something like, you probably have pretty good reason, but, you know, I act huffy. I mean, I don't have, but I kind of, well, you're supposed to, you know, and I think he laughs at it. I think he just kind of appears to you. Okay, here's the deal, you know, or eventually, you know, because I don't really do that with an attitude, but I think, I really think that he knows my heart. And he goes, That's just your way of saying you haven't heard anything for a while, and you're trusting. And you're trusting. And you're not looking anywhere else. And so, you know, the Holy Spirit is always there.
Ready.
He's ready.
Are you making a distinction when you said that there must be subjective guidelines of the scriptures? Are you making this, saying the scriptures, or are you saying the word?
No, I'm saying the scriptures at this point. Because, and thanks for bringing that up, because I do want to make this clear. You can't just know the words, you can know the scriptures. And the guidelines of the scriptures, like the first thing that I was dealing with, is there's a context of the scriptures. And so far, this word him has not used the word Savior. It has not used the word Jesus Christ. I don't think that shows up until verse 17. Uh-huh. It doesn't even use the word Jesus Christ. It doesn't. It is only given us very particular descriptions of this hymn. And the main one that it is to as many as receive, let's see. Receive, is this right or wrong? No. This is why I have to have people here in the body. Receive him. Okay. To as many as received him, that received him, and this is different, received the word, sons of God. Sons of God. All right. Receive the word. All right. This is what it's saying. Only the word can make a son of God. Only the word can make a son of God. Trials don't make you a son. You know that? Trials don't make you a son. Crisis don't make you. It only shows what's already there. Brings out what was there all along, but crisis is not the thing. It just shows what's there. The Word, God uses the Word to make a son of God. Correct? Christ, it can help you to not go off into other things if you'll just stick with the context.
problem is, in some cases, what we have is what we, it's not like we're being fed bad information. It's like we go running off in a way and look for stuff that's wrong. And like Brett said, it's not necessarily that it's this horrible stuff or that these are cults or whatever, but it's not what God's trying to say. And I find that rather ridiculous to be a Christian, or, shall I term this the better way, to be a son of my father, he is my father, I'm in relationship with him, and that's what life is all about, but I don't really check to find out exactly what he is saying. However, many of us feel very good because we check with him, and he says, but we don't realize that we reinterpret what he just said. You understand what I'm saying? And we feel good because I check regularly. You know what I mean? Oh, yeah, I read the word today. Man, praise God for that heathen stuff or whatever. And once again, let me make it clear, I don't have a problem with heathen. Thank God, I believe in the firm. God's a major miracle. He's yet doing miracles in my life, my family, and everybody else. But I'm using that as an example of, but that's not the context here. There are other places that you could not apply the word there, where it's talking about Jesus as the healer or redeemer. No, that's not what it's trying to bring out. See, that would be wrong. Just as wrong as this. So one's not better than the other. We're just talking about different aspects and staying with the context of the scripture. Alright, so what that done, you know, like I said, there are people who hardly ever check with the Lord. I had somebody come up to me Sunday, and they said, Sunday night, and they said, well, Randy, I've had this on my heart for a long time, and it's a fairly simple thing that, you know, really, in a way, it could have been like putting me on the spot. But they said, da-da-da-da-da, would you, and, you know, would you do this? And I went, well, I need to check with the Lord. And their first response was almost offended, like, what, you know, don't you know I'm okay? Yeah, and I could see that their reaction, and I said, look, let me explain something to you. You know, I find it best in my position to always check with the Lord, no matter what. Even if he comes and says, sure, okay, or whatever. I find it good to just check in because I never know, you know. And I mean, you know, I mean, if I don't hear from God and I have to make a decision by tomorrow, I think I can flow enough with the Spirit of the Lord. But I mean, if I got time, can you give me a little time to check with the Lord? And I said I didn't used to always do this on every morning, but and for my checking in, it isn't necessarily that I go fall down to the list of stuff. Everything that comes my way is subject to the Lord. And I don't know how to put this, but I have a table on my heart. Anybody ever seen my desk at home or in church? I have a table on my heart that has all this stuff piled up that belongs to God. And he looks, he picks up things, and goes, okay, here's the deal with this, and here's that. I don't sit there and throw it all up into heaven. I don't know how to explain it to you, but I, you know, but otherwise, what we think prayer is. You know, for me, prayer is staying in constant communication, which doesn't mean you're always talking. Constant communication doesn't mean you're always, did you know that? You know, I mean, you can be in constant communication. You can let your child go out on a date and feel that you have constant communication. You can also let them go out on a date and feel like there's been a breakdown and you're nervous. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Same thing with a husband and wife. You know, well, there's a breakdown. So, anyway, so there's the importance of the staying with the context. By the way, I got to cut up my hand the other day. Perfect shape for the heart. I don't want to doubt it. Scripture is good. Number two, we studied that the Holy Spirit, according to the context of the Scripture, we can be trusted to guide us in all truth. And then we stated, we started talking about what this means, receiving him. And we said it is receiving the word in order to become a son of God. Receiving the word, and the word is what makes sons of God. Not prices, not education, not anything. Not certificates, not anything. Only the word of God. Okay. But now, let's talk about this. All right, just before I came in, I jotted down. What does it mean to receive the word? What does it mean to receive the word? This is all important to it. I mean, verse 12 means nothing to us if we don't lay hold of it. It's a scripture. We heard quoted, and we can quote. But what is the point? I mean, I don't see any need or any use in living a pointless life. And, some people go, there's a lot of pastors that get offended when people question them about things. Did you know that? I don't know, some of you haven't been around churches a lot, but some of you have. There's a lot of pastors get offended when you question them about stuff. And you've heard me say that I never get offended. In fact, I like questions. You ever wonder why that is? Why it seems to be so opposite of many pastors on that? The reason is because many times, not every time, but many times, the person that is questioning is wanting an answer. That's exciting to me. Somebody's actually seeking. That doesn't threaten me. Even if I don't know the answer, it doesn't threaten me. It causes me to want to know the answer. But I'm excited about people that have questions. I'm excited. I don't even mind. Paul, I think, had a lot of questions. Negative. Maybe came from bad angles when he was Saul of Tarsus. But it was those questions that opened the door for the Lord to reveal himself. I just think that way. I know that when I first heard all this kind of stuff, man, I just went, what the heck are you talking about? You are off the wall. I mean, it didn't make sense to me. The planet is this from, And I fought against it. But deep down, the thing that was causing me to question and I don't know about that, wrestle with the whole thing, was the fact that deep down, I think I did believe it. I couldn't fit it into my head. It didn't go along with everything else I did. So it's kind of like there's a war going on in me. And I would go, explain this to me so I can stop the war. But questions are not bad. Even people who have a bad attitude never thought. I know a lot of people, sometimes they get upset with their advice. Why are you asking this question? Why did you ask right now at this moment? But you've never seen me go, Eric, dang you, boy! Praise God, and I usually just try to answer it. If I can't answer it, then there have been times that I've been, and I say, Eric, I don't know. I said, but I will do my best to get the word. And see if the Lord has shown me something. He does, I'll come right back to you. And it'd probably be good to remind me and come up to me every so often and say, did you ever find that? Oh, no. He goes, Eric's one of those people who's never had a pastor who could actually throw a question at about that. But, somebody says, well, that's because you kind of put this force behind. No, that shouldn't bother us. Nothing should make if that's outward, we're all motivated. They didn't have the perfect Jesus attitude when they asked me. Well, about the closest to the perfect Jesus attitude you're probably ever going to see in this world is you, as you said. It won't be perfect, but that's probably about the closest you're ever going to see. You might as well just figure it that way, not worry about it. They got it. Good. You see it greater than somebody else, you've got to fall down on your face and say, God, you form your son in me more and more and more. I'm jealous. Really? I'm jealous. I want more of Jesus. I want more. Here comes some more junk. If you understand the purpose. All right. As many as. So this is rather ethereal. This is whosoever will. This could be you. This could not be you. And the thing that makes the difference isn't so much a special choosing. The thing that makes the difference is as many as receive the word. Okay, so the key here is not figuring out who this is, you know, election or non-election. The key here is to understand the Father's definition of what it means to receive the word. Okay? Because the end result of that is a new Son of God. So it you don't have to worry about them. You know, it's like a sandwich. You don't have to worry about the pieces of bread. Let's just get the meat in there. Let's get to the real part of it. Okay? And that is, what does it mean to receive the word? So I jotted down a couple of things. Number one, it doesn't mean to receive the authority of the scriptures. It doesn't mean to receive the authority. I have received the word because I believe in the authority of the scriptures. Several different ways that you could talk about that. One certainly is that the scripture has authority in my life. If I think something and the scripture says something else, I submit myself to that. I must say that's very good. However, if you have a wrong connotation of what that scripture is saying and you submit to it, you know, like it's okay to like kill everybody and harm yourself. That's good, but that might not be real good. It might be better to have the nature of Christ than the authority of the scriptures. However, I believe we can have it all. The next one is to receive the word is not to receive the fact that the Bible really is the word of God. To receive the fact that the Bible really is the word of God. Now, is it good to have the authority of the authority of the scriptures? Is it good to believe that the Bible is really the Word of God? Yes. Is there anything wrong with that? No. Is these scriptures talking about that? No. Are there scriptures somewhere that probably talk about these things? Yes. But these scriptures, not talking about that, and to read that in this, receive the Word, to give your definition of the Word and not God's, in the context of the scripture, is the law. We don't want to miss the mark.
Did you just say it is not to receive the fact or to receive the fact?
It is not to receive that fact. That is a fact, and that fact should be received, but that's not what this is talking about. I hope I'm being clear. Okay, so to receive the word is not to receive the fact that the Bible should be believed. And we say, I received the word, meaning I have chosen to believe the word of God. I believe it. I believe it. Well, that's good. And you should. And there are places in the scripture that tell you you should do that. But to receive that will not make you a son of God. Only to receive what God's definition of the word is. To receive that might be good. It might enhance your Christianity. It might keep you safe from many areas. But that is not the definition of what it means to receive the word according to John chapter 1 and verse 12. Okay? And hopefully everybody in this room believes the scripture. But that will make you something. If you believe it, it can lead to it, but that's not the word that it's talking about here. I mean, I'm just trying to say that. To receive the word, as many as receive the word to them, ability, the right to become sons of God, is not to receive that the salvation message is true. Should we receive that the salvation message? We should. Is the salvation message true? Yes. Is John chapter 1 verse 12 when it says to receive the word talking about the salvation message and receiving it? No. Does possibly Romans 10:10 talk about receiving? Yes. But we're not in Romans 10:10. We are sticking with the context of the scripture, and we must do that if we are going to understand what God is trying to tell us. And if we don't, and we mix it all up and we make it a tossed salad, then we will forever be confused, and the scriptures will never be a help, though they were meant to be a help. Okay? Is receiving the word that the fact that you search the scriptures regularly? As many as receive searching the scriptures regularly, to them become sons of God. No. The Pharisees searched the scriptures regularly, and they didn't become sons of God. One did. Paul. But he was not the only one that searched the scriptures regularly. Am I saying from this that you should not search the scriptures regularly? No. Am I saying from this that the salvation message should not be received? No. Am I saying from this that the authority of the scripture is not true? No. Am I saying from this that the Bible is really the word of God, is really not the word of God? No, I'm not saying that. Or that the Bible should be believed? No. But I am saying that all of the things that I have just listed is not God's definition of as many as receive the word. It's the word that them gave you power to be the Son of God. Okay. So if a person wants to conform to the image of Christ, which is sonship, wants to be a son of his father, wants to be a son of God, wants to be in the image of his father, wants to be after the same seed, like a cow brings forth a cow, and an apple tree brings forth an apple, and God the Father brings forth his Son after the image of his Son. Then you must define this, the word, as the Logos, the complete, total thought and concept of God. That Logos is, I'll draw it the way I've been drawing it all this time, is that that is the way, that is what the Word is to the Father. He is the Logos. He is the total thought and concept. Now, once again, if we stick with this context, there has been nothing else added that can add that will say anything different. Now, there are other scriptures and other dealings, but that's not what God is trying to say to us right now. Okay? So, so to receive the word, and might I say, to include yourself in this category, as many as, for you personally to be included in this category, to know that you are there, to have assurance that you are there, there is but one requirement, and that is to receive this reality between the Father and Logos. That's all. Didn't say for you to create it. Didn't say for you to bring it to pass. Didn't say for you to believe it into existence. Didn't even really, in that sense, tell you to believe it. It said to receive it. If somebody hands you something, how do you receive it? Thank you. Thank you, I got it. And many Christians do not know how to receive. They do not. And this is a fact. I see this all the time. I get to see it most vividly at the altar. When somebody comes down and you say, da-da-da-da, and you share the truth with them, they go, oh, I'm trying to get it. You're going, you know, just receive it. Well, I'm trying to, but I can't seem to get it. Take it! Oh, thank you, Jesus. You know? It's mine. Why do you have, why is it yours? Because I received it. This reality was in the beginning before the creation. This reality is so much greater than us that we could have nothing to do with it. We weren't there. The only thing that we can do is receive it. And if we do, this sign. That's the furthest result. But I put, I wrote down, it is, to receive the word, it is that Christ is the total part of God, the Father. And you are hid and found. Okay? Where do we get that? Okay? Colossians 3. Colossians 3, verse 3 says this, for you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. And your life is hid. Okay. Alright? Now Philippians chapter 3. That was Colossians 3, but now Philippians 3, verse 9 says this. I probably should read 7 and 8 up to 9. But what things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ, yea, doubtless, I count all things but lost to the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found, and here it is, and be found in him. Not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, which if you have a concept of separateness, an individual mentality, you're always viewing everything based on your independent self, your existence, then you are under the law. Because the only way that you can measure anything is by the law. You say, but I'm going by the New Testament. The law is not a book in the sense that we think of the grace scriptures in the New Testament. It's either the letter or the spirit. When you read, you either read the letter or you read the spirit. That's the difference. The letter is the law. The spirit, this is not the class to teach us in. We do have a class called Law and Grace, which we also have one called Galatians. They really did, sure.
Yeah, I always thought that the difference, and I know, like I said, you didn't want to teach right now, but I always thought that the difference was the letter that you did, which was the law, until I realized that the law itself, what I considered the letter, is a law unto itself.
Yes.
Just like you throw something up and comes down, talking about the law that makes things operate, not just a letter of things that you, this happens.
Right, right. Now you're talking about spiritual laws. But anything that you can measure yourself by based on the outward is law. A lot of people live by the law and they don't really realize it. Okay, so we said that to be included in this category is to receive this concept. This Father Logos relationship where he, this is his total thought and concept. And that for us, we have been hid and found in Christ. Anybody want to tell me, number one, what it means to be hid, and then somebody tell me what it means to be found in Christ. What that means. Things out of it. He didn't just say, yeah, just the way it's written. said, open my eyes. Because he didn't see the letter, he saw the spirit. And many, Peter wrote about people who took the writings of Paul, which we found in the New Testament, who wrestled with them, wrested them to their own destruction. That's called the letter. So there are examples of taking the New Testament and making it Old Testament, if you will, law, and an Old Testament and making it living in the New. That's because you see spirit, or you see letter. But back to his, ready to go now.
My hope was that the total existence of what I was to count
The other one is removal from all selfish acts.
One time I was asking, I was at the place of the last people who were going to be in the tag earlier. I still don't know, but I'm excited. And I was sitting on the there's a concrete, about 2 feet of concrete over by the keyboard, and there's this big field. And I just, the Lord is like, there's like this little roly-poly that keeps running out from the field. And he's on the concrete, and he's just wide open, and there's nothing but just bugs. And he looked like he was, you know, he had like, if I touched him, he'd roll into the ball. So he looked like he was, you know, he had his own protection. But it really wasn't, because if I stepped on him, you know, he was squished. But he felt safe. You know what I'm saying? But he was just wide open, and I could see him, just spot him clearly. And then he turned around and he just ran back into the field, and he was gone, and I couldn't, if I wanted to step on him, I just jumped up and down, exactly. And then the Lord started, just said a little bit also, I really can't understand a lot, you know, but about like, okay, see this blade of grass sticking out here, the first one that he ran into? That's me as the Savior. You know, that's that part of me, but what if this whole field? You know, like, every step is a blade of me, you know, and you're hitting all of that, so basically being hidden, you get to explore me for the rest of, you know, for eternity. You got a whole field to run around in. I don't know if that...
I think it's a very, very good example. Because imagine if this shell was all beat up and battered. And, you know, sometimes when we get battered, we build harder places there where we've been hit or whatever. And he had learned by walking on concrete that life is tough. And you know, what he needs is a stronger shell. And so, you know, and every time, you know, it gets squished and hurt. And everything, you know, and he realizes he sees other people that are totally squished and going, my God. And one day he gets off of this concrete slab into this big field, and he realizes he has a protection that has really nothing to do with him and the strength of his shell. It's not a concept of being a separate entity that has to protect myself or be something in and of me. But I can run in here, be hid. And this is now all my protection in a whole different level in a way I never even considered or thought. But this now is my total protection. And that's exactly how it is in Christ. Because with this shell concept, we are constantly working on us. And there are many Christians that have this and are working on themselves right now. And yet, Paul said, you know, I'm working on being found in him. Because you can have the weakest shell in the world and be in that field, and as long as nobody finds you, that one, you're fine. See what I mean? And so it's not a, you know, if you walk up to one, this guy goes, well, look at my shell. You know what I mean? I'm tough and I'm strong and I can withstand pressures up to da-da-da, PSI, you know, pain, and I'm, you know, and you go, you know, who cares? I'm in the field. And I don't even have to worry. I don't even think in terms of me. I'm swallowed up. Sure?
Yeah, it's kind of like being hid gets a connotation of you're being hid from something.
Yeah.
Being found is you're being found by something. The person you want to be found by is being found by the Father. But what you want to be hidden from is from yourself and all of those other things that go along with a hiding.
Okay, hid from, how about if we say hid from separateness? Hid from separateness.
In other words, we are removed from always trying to work on us to be something, to measure up, and really this concept of separateness, the problem isn't the separateness, be something, measure up. It's the concept of it. We have been captivated by a concept of that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, along with that, being a kid is being hid from the separateness, but you can be hid and found at the same time.
Yes, well, you really can't. I mean, it's
separate. You can't really can't separate it. But when I said being found by the Father, you can be found by the same time, because now you're found by the way the Father sees you, rather than being hid from the way you see yourself.
Okay, well, let's talk about being found, because we can get this in here. Let's talk about being found, okay? What you just said is to be found by the Father, okay? All right. Now, how he finds you, though, is not all wrapped up in how special you are. It is wrapped up in the Word, receiving the Logos, the complete thought of God, because it says that you are found in Him. It didn't just say you were found. You're found in Him. Not having, I like that, because that not having removes that concept of separateness. Being found in Him, not having my own righteousness, not being separate, not coming up with my own schemes, not, you know. And so, to be found is like a sword, you know. There's two sides to it. Right here, said, you are not seen but by the Father, and that comes into play here. Found by the Father, okay. And somebody said, identified. The word identified is connected with both. To be hid means you are no longer identified. You can almost just leave it at that. You're no longer identified. But over here it means you are identified in Christ. Jim?
You're hid from sale.
No?
Romans 6 calls being hid, being dead in sin, and being found in the light of the God. I mean, it's the same thing, just different from all
the world. Right. So you're saying hid is dead,
sin,
alive unto God. See, because you really, if it's removal from, then it is removal unto. Okay?
I was thinking about the Father, the husband will come into the vineyard and find him in his mind. So instead of being in the wild olive tree where you were being dependent upon your own righteousness, how he finds you in the mind, not having your own
righteousness. And I really see that as, I cannot tell you how much the Lord has dealt with me. I cry out continually that I may see what you see, especially if it's kind of off to help you see better. But it's almost like what we see ourselves, with the concept of separateness, we see ourselves as an individual mind that has to reach a certain maturity and has to do a certain amount of stuff. And, you know, it's a great concept of separateness. But what Mary was saying is, it's like the husband that comes in and finds you connected to the vine with all the root and fatness of the vine. That's found in Romans. All the root and fatness of the vine. This is his concept. This is his concept. This is what we're doing. This is to receive the word, the Logos, that there is a relationship between the Father and, we'll call his Son, the Logos, that he has totally accepted you here. But he hasn't just accepted you. He has put you in there, and he accepts him, and all that pertains to him pertains to you. And let me tell you, when you were on the bad end of this, all that pertained to you pertained to him. All of your sin, he put on him. All of the punishment for every ounce of that sin, he took it on him. I mean, he totally identified with your negative side, and your concept, and the fruits of your separateness called sin. Totally identified with it, took it upon himself, died for every ounce of it, suffered every ounce of punishment for that, and then rose from the dead, having put away that old nature, and said, be found in me, not having your own righteousness, which is of the law, which means by individual acts of separate duties and responsibilities, become something. That's the law. But rather, not. You know, folks, you got the worked just as hard at not having it as you got to it having. A lot of us haven't realized that, but you do. You have to work just as hard. Paul said over there in 1 Corinthians that he didn't receive anything but Christ and him crucified. He says, when I was among you, I didn't receive anything. Now, that's powerful word. He didn't say, I received it, and I did it, or whatever. He said, I didn't. I don't receive it. Anything but Christ and him crucified. That's how you got in here, by the way. This concept didn't need the cross for it to be a reality, but it needed the cross for you to be involved. So, Christ and him crucified is the key, the doorway into all fullness, all fullness. But we live down here as separate, trying to get hold of even a little mercy drops of fullness, because we live by a concept of separateness. Now, so we're seeking little mercy drops of fullness, and we get a little taste, we go, oh, then we can have this more, and so we pray harder. And we pray in the wrong realm, we pray ignoring the Word, trying to become sons of God, trying to make the church everything that God wants. And that church is going to be the bride of Christ, married to him, bone of his bone, taken out of him, and part of him, not part of the old, part of the new man. And not only, but it is that. That's what it is. It's not the old. Jesus didn't marry, you know, a lot of people look at Hosea or whatever, Jesus is not married to a woman. Excuse my English. That's how he's not. And yet we go, yeah, but we were all sinners. Oh, he joined himself to a harlot, put us to death, raised us up, and folks, we are without spot or blemish in his eyes. And only the wonder-working thing of putting us in Christ can do that. Bone of his bone, folks. This new has been taken out of him. And is him. It is him. But it's not, it's us, but it's but we're him. Do you understand what I mean? We're not Jesus. I'm not Jesus. But I'm bone of his bone. I'm of his same substance. How about that? Now, when I figure that out and I begin to be hid in him, you know, have you ever watched a wife that is truly responds like a wife? If there's a, you know, you're sitting there and you're watching a movie and a fight kind of breaks out over there, what does she do? She kind of gets up on you. Automatic in her to kind of get up under there, you know, right there with those ribs on, you know, and he kind of stands there like, okay, get in this direction, there's going to be some trouble, you know. She wants to be hid, you know, and you got a problem when you got a woman that says, stand up, and I'll take care of this. I mean, regardless of how anybody has been trained in this world or what anybody's taught anybody, it is natural for a woman to want to be hid and to be protected. That is so normal that it is, just cannot be helped. It cannot help them. Well, if all that you've ever experienced is at best a shadow, this is the reality of that. To be hid, to be under the shadow of his wing, to find sanctuary in him. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, you know? And people try to fulfill that through men and women and relationships and everything, and you only get it best a shadow. And in most cases, the shadow is pretty rough. And it certainly isn't the fulfillment that you receive when you know this right here and you experience this. It can never even come close. It will never, ever, ever, ever be anything but, you know, I mean, Randy, can I hold your hand? You come up here and hold on this shadow. Oh, it feels so good. You know, you're going, excuse me, my shadows, huh? You know, let me throw my arms around your shadow. You know? And yet, we got people chasing shadows. And Paul said in Colossians, don't go after the shadow. Don't go after that. If we all go after it, we go after it, we go after it, because sorry. You know, I know we have needs, and I'm not insensitive to those things, but I'm just telling you that it's still a shadow, and that's why in heaven there ain't going to be no marriage, because in light of the reality, it would look stupid. You know, you go, forget this, let's go see Jesus. You know. But if you never really, really tasted that, how could anybody explain it? If you've tasted of the shadow and nothing else, you would gravitate towards the shadow having never tasted it. You would go home. Because that's better than flat nothing. Shadow is better than nothing. But not light. Light. Because you turn the, you know what? You turn the light up bright enough and there are no shadows. You get it centered right overhead where the sun ought to shine and there ain't no shadows to be found. So what we want is, you know, and that's why, you know, we chase shadows. I'll tell you why we chase shadows. It's because the sun is so barely up or down in our life that there ain't nothing but shadows, and we go chasing shadows because it feels better and it looks better. And, oh, I'd rather have this, I need this, I want, you don't know what's going on the inside of me. Yeah, dude, same old stuff's going on inside of every creation in the world at one time or another. Gone on inside of me, too. Same old, same old. But I'm telling you, there's only one fullness of this. It just occurred to me, because I've had several conversations with a couple of people here. I'm not talking about you. I didn't even think of you until I just all of a sudden realized you're probably thinking that I'm pretty sure I'm not. All of this just came to me from the Lord, okay, so please, I don't preach it. I'm only sharing this because I heard it from the Lord. And then I realized, oh my God, somebody's going to say, I'm not talking about it. I'm just saying that this is true. This is the truth. And everything else is true. It's at best truth.
That's like a different aspect of being clothed. One aspect is that we don't want to be found not being clothed upon. Well, what Paul was talking about is that I may be found in him, not as my own righteousness.
Right.
It's kind of like he walked in here by faith, knowing that he had to take his clothes off and be naked, but then realized that there had to be a clothing. That's what he had to trust in, the clothing of God, the righteousness of God, be clothed upon him. There was a time, probably, between the two where, you know, like you let go of one before you grab a hold of the other one, there's a period. And he had to learn that this is transition and being found in him, not having my own righteousness, that he had to be clothed.
Well, you know, I'm sharing this stuff to you. If you start pointing this out without talking about it, if somebody starts seeing this transition, it's scary enough, but they'll make it. But if somebody doesn't, all they get out of something like what I've shared is they feel you grabbing their shadows and cutting them off and trying to take them away. That's all they do. And you're going, I'm not trying to steal your shadow. You know what I mean? If shadows make you happy, go, you know, curl up with a shadow. But, you know, it's interesting too. It says that when the Holy Spirit came on Mary to bring the Lord Jesus, overshadowed.
Well, I was just thinking that for someone maybe, I don't know anymore, that there's hope in the fact that there's something greater than you don't know, that you know how wonderful that shadow may be, to trust that there's something even greater that the Holy Spirit is going to bring you to. You will know something. You know, and that's what you need to set in your heart, that I will know. I don't know now, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, I will know. There's an expectancy here. You know that this is going to be it. Nice.
Well, I guess I'm going to bet you will. So there will be a test at the end. Oh, yeah. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. He is our guide. He will guide us in all truth. We
rest and trust and look to actively for his instructions.